Welcome to this panel discussion. My name is Torben Funder Christensen, and I head up our public and industry affairs. We are going to talk about a very exciting and actual topic, the heat pumps. Heat pumps will play a major role of the EU Green Deal for the decarbonization of the heating sector. At the same time, heat pumps will accommodate the usage of renewable electricity. No doubt that heat pump markets are growing, and with good reason. Despite all the nice outlooks, we first of all have to ensure that the heat pumps will function, and here the refrigerants are pivotal. For that, I have three experts who are going to advocate for their favorite future refrigerant. Monsieur Canal is our expert for high density refrigerants, R32 and R454B, and Monsieur Stoll will argue for the medium density A2L refrigerant, R454C and R455A. Jörg Saar has a very exciting task to be the advocate for ultimate low GWP solution, R290. So, the F-gas regulation is demanding low GWP solutions and without compromising energy efficiency or safety. CO2 as refrigerant will also play a role, but these systems are not yet so massively present in the market for various reasons. Looking at the carbon chain molecules, well, flammability is a premise we have to live with. Now, let us turn to our experts. Which solutions do you see with the high-density refrigerants?
So, hi, Torben. Today, let me start first. And the current market of heat pump is using R410A as a refrigerant. R410A, like all the high-density refrigerant, brings advantages on the design of the unit. Thanks to the refrigerant property, the OEM were able to reduce the cost of their unit versus the legacy R47C, R134A, by downsizing the piping, the compressor, and the heat exchanger. That, at the end of the day, made the pump more financially attractive. But cost is not only the main driver of this market. The natural efficiency is one of them, and the natural efficiency of the high density refrigerant help to increase the overall performance of the unit. Knowing this and considering the uncertainty of the refrigerant future, it would be quite a natural move for heat pump to go to the next high density alternative, which are R32 or R454B.
That's a good argument, speaking to the pragmatic sense of reducing cost versus performance. Will lower density refrigerants be a valid alternative here?
Yeah, you can bet, Torben. The high density alternatives Mathieu just talked about, they are likely transition refrigerants due to their lower but still non-negligible GWP. If you are looking for a longer lasting solutions, there are two medium density HFO blends available, R454C and R455A. Their GWP is below 150, which means they will be fine beyond 2030. In addition, their flammability class remains A2L, and their lower discharge gas temperature allows for the broad operating map this application requires without any type of injection.
And if you really want to go for a low GWP, then you have to look into hydrocarbons. Propane, R290, offers an extremely low GWP, and that combined with very good thermodynamical properties. Propane has a medium pressure, and that makes it suitable for many components. There is no need for high pressure components. Then these thermodynamical properties, they allow you to use a wide application envelope, and that combined with a high efficiency. So even at low evaporating temperatures, which are pretty normal for many heat pumps, you can use propane to produce a high water supply temperatures. And at these demanding conditions, the discharge temperatures remain moderate.
The flammability of A2L and A3 refrigerants is a big concern. Heat pumps are often in the zone where people live, occupied space, so to speak. How can we assure that flammable refrigerants are really safe? There are guidelines and standards developed and under development, but how do you see the safety aspect? At the end, it's about minimizing risk by ensuring that potentially leaked refrigerant is not ignited or accumulated in occupied space.
Right. System charge reduction is definitely a key driver here, and it is valid for all refrigerants. There are many considerations to be taken during the design phase to minimize it. You will want the shortest pipings possible, especially on the liquid side. Filled vessels like filter dryer must be precisely selected. And heat exchanger, they hold quite some charge too. And this is where Danfoss MPHE helps to further reduce the charge. Indeed, our Z-dimple design allows to meet the same performance than traditional breastplate heat exchanger, but with a smaller hold-up volume.
That's correct. I can only support that statement. And especially for a refrigerant like propane, it is, of course, necessary to consider that possibility to reduce the charge as much as possible. And this is a very strong argument for a microplate heat exchanger. Then there are standards like EN378, and they put restrictions on the charge of a flammable refrigerant depending on where your heat pump is located. So reducing the charge, that helps you to offer higher heating capacities at the same location.
Yeah, that seems really plausible. But I guess the devil is, as always, in the details here. Even indirect systems are said to be challenged by flammable refrigerant leaking into the heating water loop.
That's correct, Torben. Yes, you don't want to have a refrigerant, a flammable refrigerant leaking into a heating water loop. That is, of course, a concern. Yes, and that concern is addressed in a standard, the application standard IEC 60335-2-40. That one is an international standard for heat pumps. And that standard describes several options, how you can make sure that the flammable refrigerant will not circulate in the heating water loop. One of these options is a double wall heat exchanger.
Okay, that's interesting. Why don't we have a look here? Do we offer such an option?
Yes, we do. Danfoss does offers double wall heat exchangers, and the double wall design makes sure that in case of a leak, refrigerant is not able to go into the heating water loop. So here you can see the design of a double walled plate heat exchanger. Now, if there is a refrigerant leak, then the refrigerant will be guided out of the heat exchanger via the double wall design. As everything in life, yes, there are positive negative points. So there is a bit of a negative impact on the efficiency of the heat exchange process due to the double wall. But the high efficiency coming from the good thermodynamical properties of propane, they make this negative effect quite often acceptable. On the positive side, there is an interesting point, because now with that double wall heat exchanger, there is no need to rely on heat pump external measures. So you don't need to rely on installers, on heat pump owners, to make sure that requirements are fulfilled to operate a heat pump in a safe way. With the double wall heat exchanger, you can build a safe and standard compliant heat pump in a standard heat pump design.
I see. So at the end, it's also about energy efficiency. And then we are talking about the thermodynamical properties, heat transfer, and so on. What about discharge temperatures, glide, and so on? If a too high glide is there, we may have changes in the refrigerant composition over the years, which can decrease the real, or you can say actual, efficiency of your unit.
Yeah, so let me start first with the discharge gas temperature, So the discharge gas temperature of R32 or 454B is currently higher than the legacy R410A. 454B is slightly higher and 32 way higher compared to R410A. So this high discharge gas temperature will imply the use of injection technology on the compressor, whatever it is, liquid or vapor injection, in order to cool down the gas, in order to produce, in fact, high temperature water at really low ambient temperature, such as minus 10, for example. So that brings, of course, higher cost on the unit, but it's quite a safe and well-established solution to allow the heat pump to operate at low ambient condition.
Well, the lower discharge gas temperature is one of the main benefits of the two blends, R454C and R455A. No injection is needed to cover the high lift requirements of air-to-water heat pumps, meaning low ambient and or high water temperature, which is definitely not possible with a refrigerant like R32.
You're right, Matt, but R32, like I said previously, gives over benefits regarding the component sizing, smaller compressor sizes for the same capacity, so smaller heat exchanger, downsizing the piping. And those benefits could offset partially the additional cost of the injection solution, which would be electronic expansion valve for liquid injection or and economizer and EXV, electronic expansion valve, sorry, for the vapor injection one.
I see. But glide is still for me always a signal of complexity and potential problems.
So R32 is a single component, so there is absolutely no glide. R454B, on the opposite, is a mixture, but the glide is quite limited to 1K at AI condition. So if you have to remember just one thing, that for high-density refrigerant, the glide is not really an issue.
And that's the same for propane. It's a single component, you have no glide.
And in my case, this is the one and maybe only drawback of these two alternatives. They both have a significant glide that can impact performance. But to make up for it, Danfoss has recently released new exchangers. We call them suction gas to liquid heat exchanger. Its role in the system is to push the superheat and subcooling out of the evaporator and condenser in order to minimize both approach temperatures. And as a consequence, increase the efficiency of the system. So in other words, we have a solution to make up for the only drawback of these two blends.
Okay, now we can talk for a long time about all the fantastic components here, but are they also available? I assume that many components are obviously usable, qualified with several refrigerants.
You're fully right, Torben. For high-density refrigerant, Danfoss is able to provide a wide, versatile range of line components, sensors, thermostatic and electronic expansion valves, and also heat exchangers, dedicated and optimized for heat pump application.
So in the case of R454C, R455A, today line components, sensors, controls, and exchangers, they are definitely available. But unfortunately, we're still looking at compressors, and we will definitely approve some more components in the future.
And for propane, a really wide range of components is already and for some time already available. Many just normal standard components are approved for R290. Some examples are heat exchangers, filter dryers, sight glasses, pressure sensors, many expansion valves, and so on. And whenever Danfoss Cooling develops new components, it is a requirement to have them approved for R290 by default.
Okay, so there is actually a lot of low GVP components to be selected from the menu card here. But I wonder, is a certain refrigerant more favorable for a specific heat pump type?
Yes, in my opinion, that's how it is. Due to regulations, due to standards for R290, we at the moment focus on heat pumps which are located outdoors. That's what we talk about. And these heat pumps are typically air to water units. the wide application envelope for which is offered by R290 combined with the moderate pressures and the moderate discharge temperatures make that refrigerant a very suitable solution for air to water heat pumps.
Right, and if you consider indoor units such as a brine to water heat pump, for example, high density refrigerants are an interesting solution. Maybe due to the limited flammability compared to propane, it will be more welcome in this type of application. Moreover, also due to the application requirement in terms of compressor envelope, it is possible to use compressors without any injection technology there. And then Danfoss is able to provide a full portfolio of variable speed compressors, the VZH, that are soon to be qualified with 454V and R32, that fit the needs of the brine to water heat pump application from 20 up to 80 kilowatts and ensures a smooth transition towards lower GWP refrigerant. On top of this, we also have all of our microplatic exchanger optimized for heat pump application, the line components and the thermostatic expansion valve.
So while I certainly agree with the previous two statements, I mean, R290 better suited to outdoor units and the high density refrigerant better suited to indoor units. If you're looking for simplicity and a single refrigerant for all your heat pump applications, both indoors and outdoors, the best compromise may very well be R454C or R455A.
Okay, thank you for this super interesting discussion here. My conclusion is no single winner. Refrigerant choice depends on the unit you want to go for here and the strategy of the manufacturer. Danfoss offers solutions for each of these refrigerants, but for sure the market will move to low GWP solutions. And to you, dear participants, thank you for listening in here. Please click and join us on the Q&A room. We will see you soon in a moment. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.